School is the most important thing in your life. And while I hate school, I got a PhD, and I hate school. I hate everything about it. So somebody say, E, if you hate school so much, why you get a PhD? Because I hate school, but I love options. You can have average skill, but you can't have average will. You can't have average will. Like, your will has to be phenomenal. You have to see basketball as the gateway. It's like a passport. Basketball is just your way to get in, and then once you get in, boom, then you dominate. So I'm telling you, you are not taking a test because they're giving you the test. You're taking a test that's about to change your life, your mama's life. And I know if you take the test serious, you'll kill it. When you go through your go-through, your siblings are watching you. When you go through your go-through, your friends are watching you. When you go through your go-through, your parents are watching you. And people will use your strength to get through their stuff. What up, what up, what up? It's your boy E.T. Hey, super excited. Man, it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. As I always tell you guys, just being a people person, I don't know what happens, but it's seasons. But this is the season where everybody's a people person. You feel me? Everybody's a people person during Christmas. I love it. Happens right around, you know, Thanksgiving. Everybody start opening doors for folks. They letting you over in the lane. Road rage disappears. It's a beautiful. People are opening doors, speaking to you, saying, I love it. Right around January 5th, though, they do go back to their normal sales. So we're just going to eat it up. You know, we're going to eat it up, and hopefully we can extend it to the end of January this year. Again, you know the three things, man. We're here to inspire you. I don't care what you say. Cars need gas. I don't care. They need fuel, electric, something. You just, as beautiful as they are, airplanes, they're wonderful. But without gas, they don't fly. We're just here to give you a little gas, just a little inspiration, a little positivity to get yourself going. Number two, we always want to, hopefully, we're giving out the kind of content that you could take one or two nuggets that can shift your practice. And we're going to talk about Dubai at some point. I'm going to ask them if they will allow me to talk about Dubai, but I want to talk about just how being in that environment, the largest building in the world, six of the largest buildings out of the 10 in the world, biggest Ferris wheel, greatest water park, just how when you're in that environment, how it will shift your thinking, how being around the right people and getting the right nuggets, I came back a new man. And then finally, of course, you know, we all need somebody to lean on, you know. At some point in 365, you're going to have a problem that I understand. Or I'm going to have a problem that you understand. And I don't care who you are. I don't care where you live. We just saw a robbery and a killing in Beverly Hills. In Beverly Hills, right? In a rich neighborhood. Somebody's house was broken into. And their wife was murdered. It doesn't matter if you make money or not. We live in a world where it's gonna be something. And at some point, all of us are going to have some type of trial or tribulation that's gonna require somebody to lean on, somebody to cry on, somebody to talk to, somebody to. And so, as educators, we're here for educators. We got your back. Val, why don't you give them that? Give them that email again. Why don't you give them that email again?
It is info@extremeteachers.com. info@extremeteachers.com.
Reach out. Reach out. No trials too small, no trials too big, right? Reach out. Now, I'm probably not going to answer your text, you know what I'm saying? But somebody on the squad going to answer it, and then they're going to call me if they think I need to. Then I'm going to jump in and help out. But I'm not going to be on the front end of that. But I might be on the back end of that. Katie, talk to us, Katie. What are we talking about today?
Wait, E, can I ask a question?
Yeah. Ask a question.
Okay, you're talking about being on the front end. What does your shirt say? Are those people that are on the front end?
Oh, the front end. You want nothing on the back, but okay, Frederick, Malcolm, Booker, Langston.
Slow rise.
And I'm one of those people, for real, I don't want to wait to February. You know, I just be inspired sometimes. It could be Superman. Well, I don't wear Superman, but I'm a Wolverine guy and a Captain America guy. So you might just see me with a Captain America boy on in the middle of the day. And somebody's like, what is it? I need that inspiration right now, that Wolverine. I'm about to, and everybody about to get it at 3 o'clock. o'clock in the morning asking me to write my name back. How about you? You about to get it? So, yeah, I just felt inspired this morning. I'm out here in Cali, and I'm like, yo, I wouldn't be here without them. You know, I felt inspired to be like, yo, there's some stuff that I'm experiencing that they could never experience, but they fought for me to experience. And I just don't want them to think I forgot about them. You know what I'm saying? I don't want them to think I forgot about them. And so I'm just wearing it. So people can ask me, who are they? And I can say, man, these were writers. I can tell you something. I couldn't stand reading Katie when I was coming up, but Langston Hughes, his poetry made me want to read. You know what I'm saying? Like the way he flowed, I was like, wow, that's, you know, Malcolm's discipline made me. And Malcolm was the first book I was introduced to at 12, 13, his autobiography. So yeah, they just brought some stuff out of me that I wasn't doing like I was supposed to be doing. So yeah, I just got it on for a little inspiration today. So Katie, I'm sorry. What are we talking about today?
Thank you.
Val threw me off. She one of them students in the classroom. You know what I'm saying? That got me going. She one of them students that get me going.
Sometimes when we get off course, it's a good thing for all of us. So it's okay. Hey, we're in a series about innovative instruction right now. So we are talking about how do we be innovative in the classroom in lots of different ways. Our last episode, we dug deeper into the DISC assessment and talked a ton about caring about students, which maybe doesn't sound that innovative, but man, it really, really can be when we have those good conversations about that. So today we're going to talk about experiential learning. So what does that look like? How can we create that for students? And what's the impact of experiential learning and how that can be an innovative practice that changes things in our classrooms? So I'm excited.
Valaria, are we going straight to our guests or are we going to talk a little bit before we go to our guests?
You know what? I believe that we can bring her in. I think she can really add value to this conversation.
Okay.
Good.
All right. So the next one can we do, and let's stay here with the innovation, experiential learning. Can we go King Richard? I just want to go King Richard. You know what I'm saying? I want to go King Richard. Because you know what, guys? I'm just being honest. You didn't see it?
I said, once you see it, you can't unsee it.
Okay, you can't. And here's why I want to say this is because he was actually educating. You know what I'm saying? Like, he was educating himself. And then he was educating his daughters on what he educated himself on. And so at some point I want us to go there. But I'll save it for when it's just us and I can just be blah, 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 blah. Okay. We got a guest now. So I don't want a ball hog. So Val, why don't you bring our special guest in?
So one of our amazing extreme teachers who has been around, she's been with us for I believe 2 years now. She is I'm reading it right now. She's the department chair and professor of the elementary, early, and special education department at Southeast Missouri State University, Dr. Okay. Shanta Smith. Come on, Shanta. Hey.
Okay, Simo.
I can get those elementary people in the building.
Got to bring them in. Yeah. So y'all talking about this, right? This woman right here, I'm going to tell you a little bit. She can talk about herself in a minute. Every Thursday, she's at the university. Remember this when I say this. Every Thursday, she dresses up like a superhero. She is the department chair, and she goes into all of the education classrooms, these college students, and talk to them. I mean, full-blown shoes, bodysuit, the whole nine, every single Thursday.
I love it.
And then, guess what? The teachers in the education department start doing it. Every Thursday.
Wow.
I love it. That's how you
Hey, let's not overlook that Wakanda Forever outfit she got on right now. Nah. let's not overlook that. I see you. I just want you to know I see you. Okay. I see what you're doing. All right, let me get out the way though, Val. Talk to us.
Look, so really this is Katie. Katie gonna walk us through this conversation. Wow. We'll get started with it. And then Shanta, you jump in if you want to want her to share about herself first, Katie.
It's up to you. And you want to tell us a little bit about you and your background, and then we'll jump into the topic. Sure. Yes.
I walk, talk, breathe, dream sleep education. I'm so, so serious. Education resonates in my soul. So if you are around me, if you are in my realm, you don't have a choice but to understand the value, to appreciate and respect the education that each one of us are afforded. I've had the blessing and the opportunity to be a middle school and high school teacher for 14 years in the St. Louis Public Schools, the Normandy School District, and the Ferguson-Florissant School District. Then I transitioned back to the St. Louis Public Schools for 3 years as an elementary school principal. And then for the last 12 years, I have the privilege and honor of being a collegiate professor. So I've been a principal, a teacher, a professor. So every facet of education. So when I say I walk, talk, breathe, dream, sleep education, and education has afforded each one of us to be where we are today. So I want to make sure that when I am working with anybody or when anybody is just around me, that they fully understand what an education can do for you. And when I say an education, I'm not just talking about a school education, because each one of us knows, look how I'm looking. We all have some degrees on here now, and it's a lot of people with some degrees. They think they educated, but they really not educated. So just the essence of you fully understanding that an education affords you the opportunity to think for yourself, because if we're not thinking for ourselves, then somebody else is doing the thinking for us.
Mm. Well, there you have it.
Yes. Yeah, really good. So let's talk more about that. How do we help students to make sure that they are thinking for themselves, right? And coming up with innovative ways that in the classroom, we get back to that. I know we talked recently about student-centered learning. And I think experiential learning goes right along with that. Like, how do we build in experiences for our kids where we're not, I think you might have said this in our last message, our last episode about being like the facilitators all the time, right? We don't want to always be in the facilitator role, but we want our kids to feel like they are experiencing the learning. It means something, it's relevant, it's authentic. They're having an experience that makes the learning stick for them. And that they are also within a facilitating role, and we're not just always doing it for them. So I'd love to hear if anybody's got some examples of things they're thinking of on ways that you've maybe seen that happen before in a classroom or done that yourself, where we build in this experience for kids that it has a, you know, much longer impact than a lecture take notes type of situation probably, right?
Oh, definitely, definitely. I really believe that, I've said it a couple of times, once we value their currency and we let kids know that what they have is valuable, the experiences and the knowledge that they have when they come across the threshold of the classroom, it's valued and it's valuable. Because, and it's not just my world, again, from I to impact, but from the I part, like I get to decide what we talk about all the time. I get to do, allow the kids to be a part of that. Allow the kids to really have aha moments. I call them aha moments, but it's where it's self-taught. Like, okay, they're learning how to do this. When I'm not a musician, but I watch how musicians play differently when they're self-taught. Hmm. The energy is different because they can just flow with it. Come on in here, Nell. Nell, like, yes. But they flow with it a little differently than A, B, B, B. They learn it.
The way somebody else taught them.
The way someone else taught them, but when you're self-taught or you allow the freedom, it takes it to another level. I just had to get that in. That was
good. Yeah, there's a, whenever learning is teacher-centered, then that kind of exclusively says the way that I think is the right way. Mm. You know, like when you're a teacher, you know, regardless of everything, you are one of, you know, the leaders in that classroom, and kids look at the way that you do things as the right way to do things. So if that is the case, then when we're doing teacher-centered teaching, then if I don't think like Miss So-and-so or Mr. So-and-so, then that means that I'm thinking wrong. And then it just further perpetuates this idea in the world that it's everything is black and white. No, our principles are black and white, but how we have to apply them is a whole lot of gray. And there, you know, all of the old sayings, there's more than one way to skin a cat. And it's just like, there aren't 7 billion people in the world for us all to think one way. And one of the ways that we do that, I feel like, is through this experiential learning and student-centered learning, so that I just want you to get there. However you get there, it's up to you. When you get there on your own, you get to own the process. You get to feel confident about the way that you think. It builds your confidence to know that you're not a dummy. And I know, I wish we could take a poll, because I want people to know that a lot of students are sitting there thinking they're dummies.
Yeah.
Somewhere someone has made a comment or made a statement, whether it came from home, whether it came from teacher, or a big F on a paper, and they have internalized that I am a dummy and I don't know. And so us putting the ownership on them, letting them drive where the conversations go, letting them drive where the lessons go. Listen, I want to be real with you. Those teaks in Texas, they're called teaks. I'm not sure what they're called everywhere else. You can teach those things with anything.
What's a teak?
The standard. Standard.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, those things can be taught by anything. The content literally can be a piece of paper and you can teach a teak or a standard. So this idea that we just have to like have this control and drive them, that's how you get robots. That's how you get people who don't know how to fight for change. That's how you get people. That's how you get a society that's left behind in technology. And I'm not going to go down that path. But we want well-rounded thinkers in a wide range of categories.
Yes. Yeah,
you know, and can I say this? I think just for me, I think we have to go all the way back to what is education?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because I thought that I didn't like learning.
Yeah.
But I didn't like what was presented to me as learning.
Yeah.
I love learning, but what was presented to me when I was younger wasn't learning. It was test taking.
Yeah.
That's not necessarily what I want to, like, that's not what I want to do for the rest of my life. I just don't want to take tests. I don't want to, like, I don't want to do the memorization boy. You feel what I'm saying? Like, that wasn't what I was interested in. You know, you give me something and I remember. No, but when I realized learning is life, nobody told me that learning was life. Me opening up the refrigerator, you know what I'm saying? And being able to know the difference between margarine and butter, meat, vegetables, knowing how much vegetables I need to eat a day versus meat, me knowing I got to exercise. Like, that's learning. Mm-hmm. Like, that's learning. Me knowing the difference between an off button and an on button. That's learning. Opening the door, when to close the door, shut the door, don't open the door for a stranger. Like, you know, this don't get hit by a bus. Like, this is learning. I say you get hit by a bus. Y'all think I'm playing, but when I went to Bermuda, of course, is, and I used to go to Bermuda for a grip, like 2 weeks, 4 weeks, and Bermuda is a British influence, let's say that, it's a better term. It's a British influence island, and so they drove the opposite way. So I'm walking out about to get hit on several occasions because I'm looking for the cars to come in one direction when they're going in a different direction. So I'm standing at a home that has, you know, a walkway and it's two big bushes. So when you're walking out, you don't necessarily see the street till you get in the street, and there's no sidewalk in Bermuda. So I'm about to walk out a couple times and get hit. Why? Because I'm looking, memorization. I've been taught that cars come, but I wasn't thinking. I was on cruise control. Cars come this way. I'm about to get hit. You feel me? So there was a part of me that was like, okay, E, you almost got hit. I don't know what it's going to take for you to know they ain't coming from that way no more and reprogram your brain, but you're going to have to reprogram your brain if you're going to make it home. And so you're out in the ocean. Eric, this is not a swimming pool. This don't work like chlorine and a little baby lifeguard. This is an ocean. This is how they live. They don't have lifeguards out here. You on your own. If you go out there, you're on your own. And me learning how to swim in a ocean when we're in a yacht jumping off. We're not on, they from the island, so they're not swimming and walking like we do on the beach from the sand going to work. They're in a yacht and they're out in the middle of nowhere and they swimming out. That's different than swimming in at the YMCA. You know what I'm saying? It's a different, and so I never realized, like, E, you smart. You jumped in the ocean with a group of people that swim all the time and you made it home. You got back on the boat. That's learning. But somebody told me that learning was only this. And so when my concept of learning expanded and I started seeing things on the shelf that I particularly care for, I'm like, yo, this learning thing, I'm about to do this for the, it's so bad now I'm on the plane and my wife and everybody that love me, like, yo, can we just watch a movie without the lessons from the, like, we were just watching it for entertainment's sake. I'm like, oh no, King Richard had about 10 concepts that we're going to learn today. Y'all going to sit down and we're going to walk through this joker. It was so funny. We have our masters of the game. This is like, you know, multimillionaires who do business, and they come in, you know, get insight from us. And Carl was like, yo, E, what? He's like, oh, nope, I forgot. You watched King Richard last night. That's what we're going to be talking about for the whole Masters of the Game. I said, absolutely. Matter of fact, I want you to play this scene, play this scene, play this scene. And when we finished, guess what everybody said? Man, E, that was the best session we ever had. Why? Because now I know I can learn from watching a movie. I can learn from somebody's life. So, yeah, I'm sorry, y'all, but I just want to say, let's just start all over again and stop telling kids that learning is this little small thing that happens in a classroom, and that learning is life. If you ask me, man, learning is life.
That is fine. E, you remember you took all of us to see Harriet?
No question.
E came back from seeing Harriet. He had us upstairs at the church. He went, when I tell you, E took Harriet to a whole, we was in there like, whoa. Oh my, we was just taking back. He took Harriet to a whole nother level and just broke it down and just made us look at it through so many different lenses that we felt like we watched a whole nother movie when he brought it to us.
No question.
Experiential learning. That's what that was for a group of adults.
Really. So why don't we actually see an example of experiential learning?
Yeah.
So why don't you come into my classroom and then I can introduce you to how we do some of this experiential learning. So I'm just going to prep you now to get ready. To get ready.
I'm ready.
I got my whistle. So we're getting ready to flow. See, Auntie Val, Coach Val already knows what's about to happen. So I'm just forewarning you, okay? I'm just forewarning.
I'm here for it.
I want you to kind of sweat. Let me get a sweat.
Yes. I got an example. I love it.
Yes. You don't have to do it, Auntie Val. I have to do it, Auntie Val. Yes. Now let's throw some snaps and some claps to them. Snaps and some claps. Yes, here we go. So we're going to show our students how to walk into their success and be the best they can be. I go on and on. Can't understand how I left so long. I must have superpowers. Rep 225,000 hours. Get it calculated, dude. The math, I made 1,000 songs to make it move your heart. And for the last 300 months, I made 16 albums with me open front. FA Club. Where you get your beat, I heard 93 teachers say, teach like me. Two singers, 10 comedians, and I'm still going to yell it every time it's the end. What's my favorite word? Teach. Why you gotta say it like John? Teach. You know you can't play in my class. Can't hang with the big dog man on the court. Go to it.
You can't play in my class.
I love it.
Yes, you can't play in my class. You cannot. You cannot. We got to be ready. We got to stay ready. And we got to be focused. So every class session. Too short, that's my theme song.
I never thought you could use too short in the education.
I find a song to play to set the tone in the class. So when they come into the classroom, I'm either playing some soft jazz, some chill hip hop, or some classical music to set the tone to get them ready. And then once they're ready, before I go into the lesson, I have a specific song that kind of dives into the lesson. And then when we close out, I play another song to close out the lesson. Because we know music is universal. Music soothes the soul and music brings everybody together. So sometimes teachers might not think that you can utilize music to enhance the teaching and learning process, but you can use music to rock teaching out.
I love it.
I love it. That's my kind of teaching now.
There you go now. I really like that.
Nell, I'm waiting for Nell. You know, I was already looking at you like, what's going on?
No. You know, I used to tie music into it. They'd be like, "Nell, you're an English teacher." I'd be like, "Yes." And rap is all but poetry. Mm-hmm. I used to do like a whole music project. So obviously I was at home, I was learning how to make music. And so I'd bring all my stuff in and I'd have the kids go through making a song, like writing an essay. You know, you build this part, you build this part. These instruments mean this. These instruments mean this. This rhythm, that's your thesis, because that thing is the thing that keeps, you know what I mean, kind of the pace of the entire song. I mean, you can teach anything with anything. And I love doing it through music. So that's my kind of teach.
And that's the epitome of experiential learning right there. Now it's like taking something that they might not be that interested in right at first, and then relating it to something that they're interested in and building up that skill set. I love that.
That was good. You could teach anything with anything.
Anything with anything.
That's it. I'm feeling it.
Something that giving teachers autonomy to do that too, right? Is that we're all going to do that differently. And then when you allow teachers to bring their own gifts to the table, it allows the students' gifts to rise and come to the table too, right? So I'll give you another example that's elementary level, and you guys know I'm not rapping in front of my.
You about to rap, Katie?
Come on, Katie.
I don't think you guys want me to do that.
You can do it.
So, right, we're all going to approach it differently, which is the thing. So I wasn't rapping with my first graders, I will say, but we did a writing unit that was all about how-to books, right? It's a standard, like Snell's saying, for our first graders to know how to write a how-to. And so often the curriculum way of doing that is that everybody makes a peanut butter and jelly sandwich together and they all write down the directions and we all move on the next day. But that's really not that fun. Everybody knows how to make the peanut butter and jelly sandwich. It's not very authentic to have them doing something like writing a how-to book for that, when people don't really need a how-to book for that, right? They already know how to do that. So I had a unit with my students where we were learning how-to books and we were making things out of recycled materials. So they were able to bring in whatever they wanted from home. They collected for a couple weeks, recycled random things, toilet paper rolls and, you know, newspapers, and they created whatever they wanted to out of the things. And of course that came along with, you know, building in, we read a lot of text about different ways that you can reinvent different things. And so long story short, my students all created something different, right? Out of there, somebody had a little mailbox and other ones had little inventions out of their recycled things. They wrote directions on how to do that. They tested them out with each other. They had to trade directions and trade materials. And then I had a local store that we put the whole books together to make a real book. And we had a local printer that printed them and the local store had them out for sale. And so when we were done, we walked to the store and they got to see their books that were for sale on the shelf. So it was authentic and real. And it was exciting, you know, and there were parents there. They were all buying them, of course. And the kids were like signing autographs. And then the store took us afterwards to the back to look through their, like, how they did composting and recycling. And so then we had the experience of connecting the learning that we just did with an authentic, you know, group of people that are purchasing our books and they're going to use them, right? And the store showing us how they do those things. And I'm telling you, that experience is what made the learning happen, right? It wasn't a one day we checked it off the list, but the kids can always tell you about all of those things they learned in that because of the experience we had. And I will say that example, and also, you know, Dr. Smith, your example of the songs in each day, it does make me think, like, it takes some extra work to do that, right? Like, we just have to call that what it is as educators and be honest that, like, putting those things into place does require a little extra work. So I don't know if you have advice for teachers on that, like, it's important and that's why we do the extra work, because it's powerful, but it does mean we have to put a little extra into those things.
Even at the collegiate level, I don't have to do this, but I still do lesson plans. I model lesson plans. I write the lesson plans. I show my students how to do the lesson plans, because I know depending on the school district you're in, you might not have to turn in a lesson plan. But when you think about an exceptional teacher, when you think about excellence, when you think about being extreme, and if you want to be a member of the extreme teaching team, we know that extreme teachers go above and beyond. So you are always planning. You are always preparing. So you got to dissect what it is that you're doing, and you want to make sure that you know, it's like you're putting a peg in a hole and you want to make sure it fits. So you got to make sure that you plan and prepare, because if you're not planning, from my perspective, you're planning to fail. And I don't want to fail, because I have a responsibility to make sure that the individuals that are coming into the educational system now are well prepared, because all of us know we have too many teachers that are burnt out, tired, sick and tired of being tired. And some people don't even need to be there. They shouldn't have been there in the first place, but they're there. So moving forward, let's make sure that the individuals that are coming into the profession, one, we know this is what they want to do. And two, we show them how to do it well. When they get to the phase of burnout, we show them what to do to rejuvenate themselves, to reset, so that they can go back into the classroom. So planning and preparation is key. And when you're planning, you're also planning those moments in time to take care of yourself. Because I think a lot of time when we think about us as educators are not taking care of themselves. I tell people, if you're not at your best, your students are not going to be at your best. So you got to be the best version of yourself. So you have to take care of yourself. Go treat yourself to that nails, okay? Because Auntie Vales, put them nails up, Auntie Vales. Her nails are always fire.
Always look good.
Never
go
see her. Her nails
always look good
fire.
Too.
Yes, mm-hmm. Always fire. So find some type of way to treat yourself. Like me, for example, every Sunday. You see, I'm looking you up every Sunday without a beat. I'm laying on a massage table getting a massage. And I know some people say, oh, a massage is too much. Baby, it's not too much for me, because you make time and you save money for what you want to do.
Wow.
You say that you don't have the money. Massages help me as an educator, because it makes me tap into my mind, my body, and my soul and make everything connected. Because when I go into the classroom, I know I have to be my best, because I'm going to give my students my best. So planning and preparation is key. So you might have a set time where you might plan every Sunday, or you might be on a team where a group of team of teachers get together and plan, but just plan. And when you plan, you're not planning to fail.
Something that Dr. Shanta does that's amazing with the dressing as a superhero every Thursday, Superhero Thursday, but it's a couple of things to that. So she will go into certain classrooms, but then she got a complaint filed against her from the special ed department. The student said she was going into the other rooms more than she was coming in their room, and they filed a complaint. Like, they were serious. Like, she's going to talk to the other class. She's not coming to talk to us. She didn't miss us at two Thursdays in a row, and we ain't seen the outfit.
Yes, it was an official complaint, like Auntie Belle said. A little birdie came and told me, you know, they just wanted to inform me. They were like, I'm just saying, I don't know if this is true, but I just have a complaint that you're going to these certain classrooms and you're not coming into the teachers that want to be special educators. So they need a little love too. And I was like, I appreciate this little bird chirping and giving me this signal. So I want to make sure that I spread my wings and fly into every classroom and not, you know, leave any class out. And that's funny and amazing to me. And when I share that with Auntie Val, because remember, I'm on a collegiate level. So I'm not working with elementary, middle school, and high school students anymore. Mm-hmm. These are adults. And so when we think about education and you think about teaching, the same thing as Katie, what you do with your first graders, those college students want the same type of love, because they feel slighted if they don't get the love. They like, wait a minute, you know, you came in the classroom today as Superman. Why didn't I get to see Superman? Or why didn't I get to see Catwoman? What's going on? So you got to make sure you spread the love and you're meeting the needs of all your learners and not just a particular group of learners.
It's like that was like a complaint compliment.
Right, exactly. But just think about those kids when they become teachers. They think they're going 120. They're not going 100. They're going 120. Okay, I'm reading Dr. Seuss. How can I get a Dr. Seuss hat? How can I just step up a little bit for those students? Because that's the thing. If you don't, then they think they. It's not religious, but you may be the only Bible that they ever read to know how to be a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Even though they've had so many teachers, but they at the collegiate level now. They one step from the classroom, from leading a classroom, and God forbid their supervising teacher when they cooperating teacher when they go in the classroom is dry. They just want whatever benefits they get from having student teachers. The impact is different. So if you impact at a high level, they'll always remember that. I remember my third grade teacher, Miss Biggs. I remember her to this day. Right. And I'm 54, and I can tell you my teacher I had when I was in third grade. And that's the thing. You want to impact like that. They'll remember an experience. They're not gonna remember chapter two. Come on, Nell. What your finger? When Nell finger come out like that, that's like, let me get in right there.
It's just going back to, you never know what sticks with a kid.
Yeah.
And you know, and a lot of us, especially when you teach, you know, middle school, high school, you're changing classes, college, you know, you're interacting with hundreds of kids a day. And you don't really have an opportunity to read their entire book. But I mean, you don't have an opportunity to know every detail about them and how, if you say this one thing, is going to land this way. That's why you have to take a large responsibility in how you uplift and encourage these kids. That's what I love about experiential learning, student-led learning, the DISC assessment, all anything that will point out to a kid, you are amazing, because there is enough things in the world that are gonna tell us that we suck, that we're too small, or we're too big, or we're too this, or we're too that. And so one of the things that I realized when I turned 18, you know, 19, 20, 21, you know, in college, I realized that because of the home that I came from, because of the favor that I had with the teachers that I was allowed to experience, there were just things that I felt very confident about. I'm like, yo, I am confident that you put me in a room with anybody and I'll be able to have a conversation with them and I will make them feel warm. I am confident that I can play basketball. I am confident in music abilities. Like, I just knew these things that I was good at. And I realized that a lot of my friends, they didn't have this pile of things that they knew they were good at, that they were confident in. And it's just important that we build this, a kid's profile of the things they're good at. And not just the one thing. That's how you get adults who sell their whole life out on one thing. And you got adults who chase a basketball into a ground, or they chase a doctorate into a ground, just completely ignoring all of the other wonderful things that they could have done with their life. It's just so important. And that's what experiential learning and student teaching, student-based learning, that's what it gets you. It gets kids saying that, oh, I do know how to do this. Oh, I am good at this. Oh, I am smart. It's very quintessential.
And I love something that that E would say. So when we were like fundraising to take kids to Costa Rica. So Dr. Smith, I actually was an educator in St. Louis Public Schools for 11 years. So we'll have to talk about that too. But when we were taking students, he said, you know, new experiences stretch your mind in a way that can never go back to the original dimension. So whether you're talking about experiencing from Dr. Smith what collegiate level like learning looks like, right? Whether it's Katie and your students experiencing how to write books and selling and like that whole process. And now the music making, in addition to like the paper writing, they'll never look at these experiences the same. And so I think like I've been sitting back listening about all these, like, I love experiential learning. Like, it's the way that I learn the best. It drives my passion like every day. And so I think about that. So like for our students who were in science class, and they're the ones that are like, I want an international traveling opportunity. Like, we've never had that opportunity before. And so the reality is, like, in our school, only 7% of our student population scored proficient or advanced on the biology like state exam, right? But when they studied it and went to Costa Rica for a week during spring break, and they came back, 90% of those students score proficient or advanced. There is nothing like experiential learning. Like, and obviously it's extreme, but yeah, when you're walking through the rainforest, you're like, oh, that's an example of an epiphyte, and there's commensalism, and there's mutualism, and there's parasitism. Like, there is no greater experience. And I think like even within like that program now, like we sell coffee to fundraise the money for the trip for the students. And it's like Nell said, you can teach anything through anything. It's like now I'm learning how to, you know, the whole process of coffee, or like I'm learning how to sell and what are the different sales techniques. So I think like what I love about this conversation too, in all different facets, it really is what Nell said, like you can teach anything through anything, but that when you can create an experience, students' minds will never go back to this original dimension.
I know we're in times of COVID. I know the world is different. I know, you know, there's always a cut of resources and funding. But I just remember as a kid, at least once a month, I was out of my classroom. I was taking a field trip.
Yes, yes.
Those are the moments that, like, being able to go to the Houston Museum, being able to go to the zoo, being able to go, we went to Bluebell. And I mean, these were just like, you know, like typical things you take the kids to go. When I went to the Bluebell factory and I got to see how something was made, you got to think that you're a kid. When you're a kid, you see everything at the end of the process. You rarely ever get to see how something is done. When I went to Bluebell and I seen the process of, I immediately start thinking, oh, this is how everything in the world works. This is how radios get made. This is how TVs get made, how instruments. It literally changes your mind. And we have to fight on the government level, on the district level, to get funding, to get our kids out of the classroom.
Yep.
If learning is just life, then we have to get our kids experiencing life.
I tell you, amazing. So look, one of the experiences I had in seventh grade with Miss Rosen, she was our literature teacher. After lunch, she would read to us. She said, you can put your head down, you can do whatever you want. So she used to love reading murder mysteries. And so once she's reading to us, did I ever tell y'all this?
No, but I love it already.
She's reading to us. We laying down, we doing good. So it got up to the murder. And the guy came in and he stabbed her and he left and all these people couldn't describe the murderer. And we in there like, how are they gonna not describe? This man runs in the room with a coat, runs up to the teacher, act like he's stabbing her, and he runs out. We run it, and she was just like, okay, somebody describe him. We was like, what? Describe him? Oh my God. You talking about, it was back in the day. Now they probably would have
told me. I was going to say, I don't recommend that right now. No, let's not do that.
I'm telling you. He stopped immediately. He came back into the room like, what color coat did he have on? What was he, black? Was he white? Was he short? Was he tall? Was he this? Was he that? He walked in. We were so far off. The coat was a whole nother color. Everything. But that experience, this was eighth grade, y'all. I'm 54. And I still remember that experience that she gave me that day. But it was amazing how it took us into the story. It reenacted that moment. And we'll never forget it. But we were so relaxed with her because she read to us every day. So now you know what, right? After that, every time she read something, we was at the door like this. We was waiting. Now, no one came. During reading time, it was no longer like this. Mm-hmm. She was reading waiting on the moment to happen because now she brought us into the story and she made it exciting. And it doesn't have to be a murder case, but it can still be a mystery in the classroom. Mm-hmm. Where you're reading a mystery, something is hidden in the classroom. The item that they did the murder with is in the classroom. What was it? Was it the face? Was it this? Was it that? Whatever it is, you can reenact some part of that book and bring it to life. And
there was an English teacher that used to teach Romeo and Juliet and like have all the students acted out. They were dancing together. Like everything was like a whole play. And I just thought about that. I said, man, I wish I would have had that. I probably would have been so much more engaged, you know, instead of just reading the book when I was in ninth grade. But yes.
Brandon, I hope you could find a video of the teacher that taught science, but he allowed the kids to rap it. And they did it. They had the diagram was on the floor. So as they walked through the parts of the body, they stepped on it and they moved through. You seen it, Shanta?
No.
You got to see. And they moved through the parts of the body. I don't know if they were stepping on the bones, but the kids, you know, they was like, the femur, hey. They made up their own rap song and went through the whole parts of the body stepping on bones. It was so fire.
I want each of us to just for a minute, just think about how everybody's energy is up. Everybody is all in. You're excited to describe what was happening. So when you think about this process of teaching, we all know that it works. Yeah. But how does a teacher get to this space in this place? Well, I'm going to tell you a way you can get to this space in this place. And this might be a shameless plug, Val, but I'm going to plug it out. You need to become an extreme teacher, baby. If you become an extreme teacher, baby, you're going to have the number one coach in the world. I have the opportunity to work with the educator's educator personally. Okay, I know this sister, so I already know. When Mel was talking about her confidence level, Teachers, if you're going to have a high confidence level, you have to make sure that your team, the team that you are on, you have a coach that is out of this world. You have a coach that expects nothing but the best from you, because baby, if you slacking, Auntie Val is going to let you have it. Do you hear me? And you kind of have to bite your tongue, because you might want to cuss her out, but you know you can't cuss her out because she the auntie, because if you cuss her out, then she going to be around. So, you know, you just got to kind of check yourself and say, you know, let me take this correction and go back in and do what it is that I need to do. So in the extreme teaching community, weekly, you get to chop it up with a group of educators all over the world that are doing amazing things, where we are supporting one another at all levels. So it's just, it's all levels in all walks of life. Not some people aren't even teachers. They just believe in education and they want to be coached by the educator's educator. And so your confidence level, like Mel said, when you go in a classroom, you might say, okay, I want to try this thing. Let me chop it up with Katie and Sam so they can just kind of give me some ideas, and you kind of talk it out. And then you go in the classroom and you actually teach it. And then you come back to the team and you talk it with the team and you're like, whoa, I'm really doing it. So when you surround yourself with tens, you have no choice but to be a 10. Because if you're anything less than a 10, they're going to be like, now this is a championship team. And right now you're not acting like a champion. So you need to make up your mind. Do you want to be part of the championship, or do you want to be over there with those people that they haven't figured out what they want to do? So I'm telling you, your confidence level, like Neil said, is going to be through the roof. And you don't worry about what's going on in the classroom down the hall. Like Katie said, you don't even worry about Katie. If the principal is going to come in and tell you what you can and you can't do, you do it because you're extreme and you know that it works. So when the principal does come into your classroom, the principal is going to be like, Auntie Val, that was fire. In your head, you're not going to say it to the principal, but you're like, I know it's fire. Okay. And I'm not going to do anything but what's good. So your whole being is on a whole nother level. So if you don't know what extreme teaching is, you need to go to www.extremeteachers.com.
Let's go. But I'm going to tell y'all something. Community is so important. Can you imagine if you're around people that say you can't? So when Nell's saying, I could bring music into anything, if she surrounded herself with those teachers that, that's not going to work. Don't try that. Or when, you know, when Shanta's dressing up like, I said, Shanta, when she started dressing up, I was seeing videos, like, and then she does a motivational message that she puts out to all other educators. Amazing. But then you're looking at Katie and you're like, Katie, why we gotta rank? Why we gotta go pick a book? Why I'ma assign them a book? Katie's like, no, let them pick the book that they want. They'll want to read. Sam is like, let's go to another country. You're like, wait, hold on. We in the inner city. Why we going to another country? Let's just go downtown. No, you have all of these things, but if you're surrounding yourself, with extreme teachers, not just the program, but like-minded teachers.
Yeah.
You're going to go, what are you doing? Katie already got me thinking about books. And I'm not really even in the classroom, but I knew about Lexile scores, but I still was picking the book. But Katie like, no, give them the option. So then it becomes something they want to read. I'm like, what can I take the kids to? Okay. Now I know already. Now I'm going to tell you this, from one of these podcasts, Sam was talking about the assessment that her friend created, right? We took this, when we go to schools now, we give them this assessment. When we went to Dr. Mao's school, we gave them a support assessment, how the administration can support their teachers just from being in this circle. And then the guy who created the assessment, I invited him to come on and talk to the teachers that Shanta's talking about. So he came on, he talked to them, that assessment now goes out in their schools, and it just keeps happening like that. But you have to surround yourself. Mm-hmm. People that's pouring into you so you can pour out. Mm-hmm. So community is so important, but guess what? This is our experience. We have the experiential learning as well. Mm-hmm. We're doing it too, because our experience is about gathering from others. Come on, Neil, I see you muting and unmuting.
Because it's this, and you know, teaching, especially in lesson planning, it involves, you know, a lot of assignments. You got to figure out how to do this assignment. This is what I propose, you know, and I don't have no real data, but I propose that one experience, one student led, one experiential assignment will probably cover, I'm gonna just throw 10 Just 10 of your little write-up assignments, 10 of your little worksheets, 10 of your sit at your desk, because all it takes is one thing for those kids to latch onto, and then you can use that one thing to unpeel the onion and all of its layers, and you can always point back to that experience versus you moving to the lesson, and now you're moving to this worksheet, or now you're moving to, you know, to this thing out of the workbook. One experiential learning assignment, I would measure it'll take up 10 of your little run-of-the-mill assignments.
Absolutely.
Maybe even more.
Sam, you described it when you talked about the Show Me the World project and the learning the sales and the the way the coffee's made, all those things. She described that exactly. That's what that is. All those standards, right? And same thing when I talked about the writing, it started as a how-to writing. But, you know, we covered so many science standards because we were talking about recycling and composting and all of these different things. And there's also additional writing standards on publishing and when they made a book. So you end up.
Katie, don't do the cross curriculum now. Don't do the. Don't start doing the cross curriculum now. Hey, if you put the experiential on top of the student led on top of the cross curriculum, you might not have to teach.
But they learn it. Yeah. But they learn it.
And then guess what ends up happening? You can kind of start moving and take a back seat, and your students start leading. So they're teaching. Yes, they're teaching. And you're like, say what? It is amazing. It's amazing to see it in action. It is a beautiful thing.
I love it, y'all. All right, let's do round robin. Y'all ready? All right, so we'll start with our guest, and then we'll go our guest, Katie, Sam, Nail. So here's the question. Tell me one thing I can do. One thing I can do to get started.
One thing you can do?
One thing I can do to get started on this track. Okay, because right now, I get it. Y'all saying do it. I get it. Okay, on your marks, get set. Wait, I'm not ready. So what's that one thing as a teacher, new or old, what can they do? Let's start with you, Dr. Shanta.
One thing you can do, I'm going to give you one of the C's from extreme teaching, captivation. Captivate. You got to captivate your audience. So on Thursdays, when I put those superhero outfits on, they're already like, who's she going to be? What's she going to do? And what does this superhero do? So you got to captivate the audience. So with that captivation, that energy, that passion, that drive is just there. You're excited to be there. Your students are excited to be there. It doesn't matter what you're about to teach. They're just the anticipation. Like Auntie Belle said, think about when she said when her teacher is ready to read. This third grade, she said, and they like, Rick, ooh, what are we going to read today? So captivation. Utilize captivation to bring your students in.
I love it.
I'm going to say start simple. So we're talking about all these big projects to create experiences and field trips. I loved Nell's little speech for us on field trips, but start simple and it doesn't have to be big and huge. So I took a group of about 15 high schoolers to the local library, and two of them had said they'd ever been there before. And we just walked there. It was free. And I like picked up snacks so we could snack along the way. They were so happy because I was letting them snack while we walked to the library. And then I just made it fun. You know, we walked around and saw the different things library has to offer. I was just trying to convince them to go to the library. That's it. That was my goal. It wasn't a standard. I'm not going to lie. I just wanted them to go to the library. But you know what? It was an experience. It built relationships. It built love for books, for realizing what was in their community. And it was free and pretty simple. And I hope it's something that they'll remember. So I think it's okay to start with something simple.
Look, I know what the card catalog is today because my teacher took me to the, and yes. I don't have it anymore, but I remember. Come on, Sam.
And just quickly with that, Kate, the fear of the unknown, right? It's like, oh, that library is right there, but like, I might not know how to navigate it or whatnot. Yeah. But when they have that experience, that's important. But I would say, so as we're approaching next semester, take a look at your curriculum, right? Take a look, and it doesn't have to be in 2 weeks. It can be in 3 months when you end up teaching a lesson, right? So that you have time to prepare for it. And look at, try to figure out an experience that you could include even just one lesson, right? Just start with one lesson. And if for some reason you're not able to make that connection or you're struggling with that, that's okay. Utilize your students. You still have several months, right? Ask your students, hey, we're probably going to go over this lesson. Like, what experience would you like to have of this, you know, within this subject area? Because they will help you get there. So that would be my recommendation.
I love that.
Counsel is Neil.
Before I do my one thing, I want to speak to Katie's library. I remember the first time I went to the library outside of school. And it was the first time I realized that I had access to books that no one could make me choose from a certain category, if that makes sense. Yeah. Your school library is your school library. You know, it's stuff that's not in there that you would want to be in there.
Yeah.
I went to the Houston Public Libraries when I realized, oh, books are at my disposal and I can choose whatever I want. So taking your kids to the library is a very impactful experience. My one thing is, I think a lot of teachers' efforts are empty. And what I mean by this is they're trying to make kids excited and they're not excited about nothing in their life. It is very important that you grab a hold to something personally that you're excited about. A lot of teachers are like, you know, on their masters or on their doctorates, you know, doing whatever that other thing is that you're doing or that you spend your hobby doing. Like, you need to be excited, and that is what you need to take and try to give to your kids. Mm. You can't go with empty efforts. Like, okay, cool, I want them to be excited, but I myself don't know what it is to be excited about something, or I'm not excited about anything in my life right now. Makes you pessimistic, makes you cynical, makes you a Debbie Downer. Get excited about something, and then that will translate over into your kids.
That's good. That's good. Mm-hmm. All right, so sing with me. Free your mind. Hey, the rest will follow. Hey, don't be free your mind. If you free, that's what got you caged and stopping from trying things is your mindset. Your mindset has built this cage like, this is what I have to do. This is what it needs to look like. This mm-hmm. is the only place I can go. No, it's not. Free your mind first. And then just whatever, try it. You might like it. Just try, or the kids may like it. It may not be about you. Just figure out, just do that one thing, whatever that one thing is for you. But whatever that thing is, they say, I can't do that. Yes, you can. You may have to scale it down or scale it up or whatever, but go for it. Go for it. Email us too. Let us know how it turns out. info@extremeteachers.com. We are getting some messages from you guys. We love hearing from you because it lets us know that we have a purpose and it's being fulfilled. So we want you all to grow with us and go with us. So join us as we walk into B's office. All right, B, take it away.
Welcome back. Welcome back to the Office Hours, the coolest principal's office on the face of the planet. We've got a lot of good stuff to go over today. I want to recap and review some of the most impactful points from today's broadcast. Just you and me, we got some good stuff. So let's get right to it. Point number one is E.T. said learning is life. See, learning is all around us. Every single day, we're learning, we're growing, we're adapting to our environments, and we're getting experiences. So we have to expand the concept of learning for our students. We have to show them what learning really means. We have to start redefining education. And going off of that, you can enhance the learning process however you see fit. You saw how Dr. Smith took it to the next level, using music to increase engagement and make her classroom that much more dynamic. So you have to ask yourself, how can you redefine education to take things to the next level, right? Number two, you can teach anything with anything. We hear Auntie Val say all the time, teach without teaching, but Nell dropped what might have to officially be named the Extreme Teachers Quote of the Year, which is you can teach anything with anything. You can be creative, you can use music, you can use activities, you can use anything to teach if you embrace your own creativity and natural gifts. See, learning doesn't have to look a certain way. It doesn't have to follow a certain form or mold. It doesn't have to fit into a box. It just has to be effective. Remember that. Number three, last but not least, planning and preparation are key. Now, this one actually stuck out to me because we had just been talking about super creative, super spontaneous, super out of the box thinking. And all of a sudden, Dr. Smith hit us with, yeah, but we're doing all of these things, but this is planned. This is intentional and this is deliberate. Because if we're failing to plan, then you're planning to fail. And I thought it was really impactful for her to say, look, we have to have both a solid, well thought out plan and a little bit of spontaneity and creativity sprinkled on top. So like Auntie Val always says, it's not about finding a balance between both. It's about finding a rhythm between both, knowing when to do each, because we need both of them at a very high level. Now, a couple of announcements. Auntie Val and I, again, we've been on tour. We've been hitting the road, going to different schools and giving our solutions to schools' problems. If you want those solutions for your schools, please email us info@extremeteachers.com. Get added to our tour schedule. We would love to come visit you and your school. And as always, visit our website, www.extremeteachers.com, to learn more about becoming a certified extreme teacher, take the DISC assessment, explore all other products and services that we offer that can help take you and your school to the next level. And of course, do not forget, link in the description below to nominate an extreme teacher that you know that deserves to be recognized on this podcast. And speaking of extreme teachers that deserve to be recognized on the podcast, we're bringing you another one of our certified extreme teachers this week, Miss Tiffany Johnson. We asked her what she loves about teaching, and she said this: the ability to impact and influence and know that what you do every day has a direct impact on the world. I love the aha moments and building relationships with the students. The world is constantly changing, and being in education allows me to have a hand in being the change I want to see. It makes me take responsibility for the woman I am because I know I am connected to who those around me become. Last sentence is big time, isn't it? Tiffany also volunteers with Extreme Teachers and has become an invaluable member of the team, of the squad, and helps make all of this possible for you all. So thank you so much, and big shout out to certified Extreme Teacher Tiffany Johnson. Now, as we close another call, I can't help but think of the value of community. We spoke about it a lot in today's call, and ET says at the beginning of every single podcast, we want to be that community for you that pushes you, that gets you around like-minded people, that helps elevate all of us higher together, getting better together. Because getting around extreme people is the absolute best way for you to become extreme yourself. So check this out. A few years ago, I was visiting a really good friend of mine who happened to be a world champion on the still rings in gymnastics, right? And during this visit, we end up going to LA Fitness to hit a workout together. And keep in mind that at this point in my life, I was considered a fitness professional. You know, I was doing personal training. I had my own coaching clients. I was a gymnast, an athlete, et cetera, et cetera. And when I would lift weights, I was used to doing maybe 3 or 4 sets of any given exercise, which is a totally normal range, right? So I'd go and say, okay, I'm going to do 8 reps of these curls or whatever, and I'll do that 3, maybe 4 times. That's what I was accustomed to. We walk into the gym, and this guy, my friend, right? He says, let's start with 10 sets of 10. And I was like, excuse me? I was shocked. I was baffled. I thought I was going to die in real life. I thought I was going to drop dead on the floor. The weight was going to fall on my face, and that was going to be it. My end time was going to come in that gym because it was that incredibly difficult. But watch this. It expanded what I thought was possible. See, I never would have even considered doing 10 sets of 10. Why? Because at that time in my life, I was good, but he was extreme. He expanded what I thought was possible for me. So understand, when you get around a certain caliber of people, you're going to expand what's possible for you faster than you could possibly imagine. So we appreciate you rocking with us and jumping on board with this mentality of being extreme. We can't wait to keep learning with you, keep growing with you, keep being extreme with you. But until next time, watching the Extreme Teachers video podcast, and we'll see you on the next one.